UMass Amherst biologists who study climate change say they've discovered 16 giant viruses previously unidentified in a western Massachusetts forest. It might sound ominous, but Professor Jeffrey Blanchard said it's an exciting discovery, which they're still uncovering the significance of. He spoke with me in the studio about what they found in Petersham and why that surprised them.
Oh, it was just so amazing. These viruses are as big as bacteria. And they've only been discovered in aquatic environments, mostly marine, but in snow. And so this is the first time they've ever been discovered in a forest ecosystem. And we discovered 16 of them.
And so lots to unpack there. Let's start with, why do you think that you found them in a forest setting as opposed to, like you say, you usually find this in a marine environment?
People just haven't looked. We were using a special new technique that enabled us to look at more cells that were in the environment than other researchers have looked at before.
Okay, and so I had read, I think in NEPR, that this may be connected to global warming, warming soils, but you're saying no, it's just a different technique there that was used.
Right, so there is a connection. So we are part of a long-term experimental warming site at Harvard Forest, one that's been going on for 20 years and another one that's been going on for about 30 years. And so we were sampling that soil, trying to understand the bacterial diversity in that soil and how it's changed in response to warming.
Hmm. And so then you found not only one, but 16. So is that common that you would find this many at once?
No. So that's extremely unusual. So even in aquatic environments, people haven't found this many at once. And it's the scale that we've done this new technique at, I think, that allowed us to see this new biodiversity.
And so I know you're sort of just discovering and unpacking all of this, but do you have any sense of what the implication for having discovered any of these 16 might be, how they might be used, or what they might help us understand?
Right. So there's a number of implications, both from a pure science discovery. These are viruses that are as big as some bacteria and have thousands of genes. Most of these genes, we have no idea what they do. So they're probably very important for ecosystem function, but they're also potential sources of new enzymes for biotechnology that might have different applications.
So in the past, I know some of your research has helped with probiotic development, mm-hmm. things like that. Any connections you can make yet, or too soon to say?
Too soon to say. We don't know what they do, but there's a lot of interesting space to discover.
You mentioned a couple of times that they're as large as bacteria. Still can't be detected by the human eye, though, I assume.
No. But with a common microscope in a laboratory, like you'd find in a high school laboratory, you can see them.
And so when I know that this was developed in collaboration with some colleagues in California because a UMass student was on fellowship out there looking at this. Walk us through, you know, what you're saying as the findings are being reported back to you, I assume, from this student.
Yes, the student Lauren Atio was there in California on a fellowship, and she was working with a bioinformatist, somebody who specializes in analyzing computer data. His name is Frederick Schultz. And Frederick's actually the one that identified them in our data, and then they communicated this to me, and I was excited. These giant viruses have only been discovered in 2004 was the first genome sequence. So they're really new to our understanding of life. And then to have 60 new ones in our data set was just amazing.
And when you say giant viruses, I know you said that some are as big as bacteria, but I think people think of like monster movies, you know, they're
right.
Going to be attacked by them. Can you quantify, you know, what giant means or what it looks like?
Yeah, so I would love to make these 50-foot giant virus sculptures at Harvard Forest where they have these icosahedral heads. So sort of multi-dimensional heads to them. But they're more on the one micron scale. And so, but part of the surprise and part of why we detected them is we were trying to isolate bacteria. And they came out with the other bacteria that we isolated because they were so big.
And so do we know if they can be harmful to either humans or the forest even?
Right, so as far as humans go, we don't know. There have been reports of giant viruses in our gut system, but we think that they're just passing through or living on other protists, that they're not directly harming us. in the forest ecosystem, they're part of the natural soil food web. They often affect other small microbes, protists, and get inside of them and develop and multiply and then lyse those cells.
Is there any way to know? I know you said you think you discovered them through a technique that hasn't been used previously, so they've probably been there for a while, just maybe not detected. But do we know, you know, what role they're playing out there yet?
No, so we don't really know exactly what role, other than sort of basically infecting other microbes. And then when they lyse the microbes, they release carbon into the soil for bacteria to grow. So it kind of completes the sort of carbon cycle.
And I know that you said this is part of a longer project. You've been working out there in Harvard Forest. How often do you go out? How often are you, observing the soil out there?
Yeah, so I like to go out a lot. It's a beautiful place, just north of the Quabbin. It's also called the North Quabbin Woods up there. We, depending on the year, are taking more samples some years than other years. We're usually out there once a month, every 2 months, to be taking samples. Of course, we can't really see anything looking directly at the soil. We've got to bring it back to the lab and either be looking under a microscope or doing this DNA sequencing technology. Because that's really how we see the microbes, is through their DNA.
And so when you're out there in the forest, I know you say that you're bringing up that soil, you can't detect any difference maybe that day, but are there observable differences to the forest that you've noted, you know, being out there as frequently as you are?
Oh yeah, so in our long-term experimental warming plots, this sort of rich organic layer on top of the soil is about this thick. And so that's, you know, your breakdown of leaves and stuff. In the plots where there's been long-term warming, it's about half of that. And so all of that carbon has been respired up into the atmosphere, contributing more CO2 up into the atmosphere.
And so with that change, what do you think the impact could be?
So our soils are becoming more depleted in carbon. And you can think of, if you go down south to the tropics, most of the leaves and other organic material cycles really quickly in the course of a year. And so there's no organic layer on top of the soil. And so that's essentially what the long-term warming plots are starting to look like. There's less and less of the organic material that we think of as rich part component of soil.
And what does that rich soil typically help with?
So that's where you find a lot of the life in the soil. If you look at it this time of year, you'll see white strands of fungi, the mycelial fungi, growing through that. There's lots of bacteria. There's sort of all sorts of mites and springtails and little macroscopic organisms.
So really the sort of thriving underbelly of the forest floor?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. In terms of the discovery of these 16 giant viruses that we were talking about at the beginning, do you have a hope for what the discovery might mean?
Yeah, so at one level, it's just all this amazing new biodiversity. You know, I feel like it's like walking onto a continent for the first time, and nobody's ever looked at what life on that continent is like. We found all this in just a teaspoon of soil at Harvard Forest. And so nobody's looked anywhere else in the world in forest ecosystems. And I'm sure there's an incredible amount of diversity and much to be learned about how these viruses take up new genes and have new functions and roles in ecosystems that we never imagined.